ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الكلام كتاب الله، خير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، كل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، كل ضلالة في النار. وبعد، قال الإمام الحافظ أبو بكر محمد بن حسين الآجوري رحمه الله تعالى في كتاب الشريعة بحديث 424 أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول: إني سمعت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول، أي قال زيد: نعم يا ابن أخي، إني سمعت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول: إن الله تعالى لو عذب أهل السماء وأهل الأرض عذبهم فهو غير ظالم لهم، ولو رحمهم كانت رحمته خيرا لهم من أعمالهم، ولو أن لامرئ مثل أهد ذهبا ينفقه في سبيل الله حتى ينفضه لا يؤمن بالقدر خيره وشره دخل النار. It has been narrated here with an authentic line of narration. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying is, if Allah was to punish the people of the sky, or the gathering of the sky, of those of the sky and those of the earth, He would punish them, and He is not a zalim, tyrant on it. And if He was to be mercy upon them, His mercy upon them will be good for them due to their actions. Even if a person has a amount of gold and he spends it in the path of Allah till he clears it, but doesn't have faith in the decree of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed, the bil qadri, of the good and the bad, he will enter Jannah, he will enter the hellfire. This is among those hadiths which clearly indicate to us that our behaviors, our attitudes, and our living on the globe, and the life of the globe and its expenditure, and the attitude and behavior is not going to result to escape us from the hellfire if we did not carry the proper creed, the proper belief. The belief is the foremost, fundamental, which is going to let me enter the paradise or be avoided from the paradise. This hadith says very clearly, if Allah wants to punish those of the sky and those of the earth, He wouldn't be a tyrant in His punishment. I mean, He won't be wrong in punishing them. And if he was to show mercy upon them, his mercy upon them will be good upon them due to their action. And even if a man or if a person of them were to have a good amount of gold, spend it in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala till he clears everything of it, but he doesn't have faith in the qada wal qadr of the good and the bad of it, Allah will put him to the hellfire. So all that expenditure, all that he has sacrificed to Allah is not going to be worth. The faith is what is going to be counted first. If that faith is not available, all what he may do in expenditure or whatever the worldly action is going to be countered later, after that. The faith is the foremost. This hadith has been narrated with different lines of narration. We get it collected by Imam Ahmad in his Musnad, and also we see it has been collected by Imam Al-Ajr in his Kitab al-Sharia, and the level of his authenticity falls into the grade of Hasan. It has also been narrated by Imam Abu Dawud in Kitab al-Sunnah, Imam Ibn Majah in Kitab al-Qadr. Thus, these different lines of narration bring this to a status of authenticity, which is known as Hasan. Although a single line of narration which carries in the narration of Imam Ajur in Kitab al-Sharia has a weakness due to Abu Ishaq Amr ibn Abdullah Subayi, the Mudallis. But it doesn't affect authenticity as the text is authentic with its other narrations. This is a matter which I have to elaborate to you all today in the gathering. Although my class is usually in the Tamil language, but today I prefer to talk in English to make it beneficial, island-wide, and worldwide for the situations of the Muslims today. With this, yes, this hadith has to do a lot to teach us, to educate us in our present situations that we are going through, either in the land of Sri Lanka or in other parts of the globe. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if he was to punish those of the sky, or if he was to punish those of the globe, he wouldn't be wrong in it. And if he was to show mercy upon them, it would be better for them due to their actions. And if a person of us, I mean among that of the earth or the sky, whoever it is, got a Mount Uhud, is one of the biggest mountains described to show the quantity of the matter, which is one of the mountains in the valleys of Medina. If that amount of gold equivalent to that Mount Uhud be spent in charity, not just public charity, but for any service, for the path of Allah, especially for the path of Allah, fi sabilillah, that means he is particularizing, choosing the things which are worth to be done for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to promote his religion, and those that which is fixed with confirmation of rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was to do on that, he spent all of his money, or the wealth of the gold, or the amount of the earth, finish them all. But he doesn't have faith in the qadr, what Allah has decreed, the good and the bad, Allah let him the hellfire. What does this hadith say? It says very clearly, you being generous to Allah, in your terms, you can never be generous to Allah. You thinking that I have been spending for Allah's sake, and all those your contributions, activities, which you might be accounting them, I spent that, I spent this, I did that, I did that. If it is so, Allah is showing one of the biggest which a man could spend is the sample of a gold, the amount of a mount of Uhud. If that much of he has to spend and finish everything, but in his faith, he doesn't have a faith of what Allah has decreed, the good and the bad. What is going to result to him? He has those rewards. He's going to the hell. What does it tell me? It tells me, before I do my action, I have to correct my belief. If my belief is corrupted, and I don't bother about it, and I go on doing my actions, my dear, even if we worship any worship, if it's not based on the pure creed, it's not worth to be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when the creed is corrupted, that means the belief is corrupted. What is the belief? It's a contract between you and your Lord. أَحْدُمْ بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنْ رَبُّكَ. It's a contract between you and your Lord. In this ahd, in this contract, you don't come upon to what he wants. He's putting in some condition. And he disagrees with it. Then to him you're out. You don't accept. It's like you're getting into office. You don't agree with the agreement. And you want the office to accept. You want the office to accept you and pay you the monthly salary. Will it happen? Never. You have to go and work in a house. And the house owner has conditions. But you're not ready to abide by it. But you're going doing whatever you want to do. On your own will. At the end of the day, you're expecting the house owner to pay for you. Will it happen? You'll be thrashed and slapped and sent out of the house. And no one is going to blame you. Similar. If anyone is going to expect that I should be rewarded, I should abide by the condition. For what I need the reward. If that is what I am between me and with another creation who's like me, then how much it has to be more between me and my Lord, who has more rights than anything else. The one who created me, the one who gave life to me, the one who will take my life when he wills, everything. And he is putting some conditions. This is the way you have to live. This is what you have to believe. And in these conditions, I put ahead my agreements and disagreements. Subhanallah. What does Allah say in the Quran? وَدْخُلُوا فِي السِّلْمِ كَافَةً. Enter to the submission completely, not partially. When you go to submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, don't think that just because you submitted in some terms, some matters, that you have done the submission. No, my dear. Allah is expecting from you what? A complete submission. وَدْخُلُوا فِي السِّلْمِ كَافَةً. Enter in the submission completely. Now I should know that. Am I completely submitted to my Lord or not? What he is expecting from me, the conditions which he has applied, if I agree When I say I have no word to claim for agreeing and disagreement. Rather, if I submit the right word to say, there's no question of saying I agree to my Lord. There's no question of saying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I agree to my Lord. Who are we to agree with it? Rather, we have to submit to Him. Because He is the Lord upon whom we all depend. If His anger addresses us, nothing will escape us from it. So that is for a Muslim who believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to him the foremost is what? To be a perfect, better Muslims to Allah. After that only anything else. If the Muslims are in trouble, they are not being secured, they are in hard time, whom do we depend? We depend upon our Lord. O Allah, secure us, give us safety. So that is then, I have to turn back to my Lord. So my security in the life and after my death is upon my belief. How best I had that my faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How firm my faith was on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The better the security you will have in the world and the hereafter. When I don't abide by His conditions, and I don't submit to Him as a sincere true Lord, a true slave to the Lord, I don't do what I'm expected to do or asked to do, but I expect all the rewards. I want everything to happen right. Subhanallah. Will it happen? It won't happen. Rather, what does Allah says? If someone is to abide by what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders, He guarantees him not only security from that which is available in front of my eyes, even from the angels from the sky will come for your security. So Allah's statement upon us, if we are to be firm on our faith in Him. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُ تَتَنَزَّلُ عَلَيْهِمْ مَلَائِكَةً أَلَّا تَخَافُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا وَأَبْشِرُوا بِالْجَنَّةِ الَّتِي كُنْتُمْ تُوعَدُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says very clearly in the Quran, who says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَ اللَّهِ, those who say, our Lord is Allah. And then what does they do? Just say the state. No, there is a condition. What's that? ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُ. Then he be firm upon what he said. How do you be firm upon what he said? When you said Allah is my Lord, you become a slave. That's the meaning of when you accept him as his Lord. That means all his commands are accepted by you. Then you are upon to the action on it. All what He orders I do, all what He forbid I keep away from it. This is the proof that it's the istiqamah. But I don't listen to Him. I don't avoid what He forbid to me. There's no istiqamah, there's no istiqamah. Istiqamah is to listen to His commands and to be a slave to the Lord Allah and to make sure that I am not earning His anger. Rather, I am upon His mercy by being a humble, truthful, sincere slave to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So those who say, Allah is our Lord, and be a sincere, truthful, honest, that means firm on it. What does Allah say to them? تَتَنَزَّلُ عَلَيْهِمْ مَلَائِكَةً. for that we will set down angels. My dear Muslim, there is no better man than you. Under this sky, above this globe, there is no creature which is more well-beamah than the human. For his belief, Allah is using his other creatures to come ahead and secure him, to comfort him. So how much Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is kind to us. He is doing it, whether we know it or we don't know. But he is also telling us. Why is he telling that to us? That we will send down angels to you from the sky. So that you be confident. You be brave enough. You don't bother of what's happening against you, troubling you, and threatening you. All these are things which we are not to account it at all. Because our Lord has given me a guarantee saying that تَتَنَزَّلُ عَلَيْهِمْ مَلَائِكَةً أَلَّا تَخَافُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا أَلَّا تَخَافُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا. Why is he sending malaika? For me he is sending it. For what? That you no need to fear. No, you need to shiva. Shiva is a slight thing which I may get, threatened from a voice, or frightened from a matter. Even that you no need to happen to you. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling to you. Angels are getting down for you, my dear. And there's nothing which will frighten a Muslim. The threatening of the kuffar, the battling of the kuffar, the taking the lives of our kith and kin, destroying our property, seeing generation after generation, community after community being destroyed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you, don't worry, don't get afraid. Because to us, life is with our Lord after our death. Living on the globe is a span period of time. Whether we like it or we don't like it, everyone is going to face the death. Whether I'm in the jungle or on my bedroom, on my bed, I'm going to meet the death. No one can delay it a minute. But everyone has to know that every second we are running towards our death. We're getting closer. Whether you like it or you don't like it, my dear, we're getting closer to this death. So that is a thing which is going to happen to me. I cannot make it out of my program. The death, I can't unfix it from me. It is fixed to me automatically. Whether I like it or I don't like it. Whether I hide or I be apparent, that's going to meet to me the time it is written on me. But the issue is, I don't know when it's written to me. Maybe this minute, maybe the later. Now it is upon me to be ready for it. وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. Do not meet the death except you are true submitters to Allah. This is what Allah commands. So if a death is going to come, what does it mean? It means Allah wants me. That's the simple message I'm getting. Allah wants me. Allahu Akbar. He wanted to send me to the earth. Why are we worried? We were not worried. We are getting children, are we worried? No, we are happy. That's what Allah wanted to come to the world. No, He wanted that to come back. Should we be worried? It's not just that we worry that when Allah is calling me, the globe which I came, the land which I was born, I had a hard time living on it. Hardly I ate and drank. Hardly I served myself. But the lane which I'm going to go to, I don't need to have hard time for drinking anything. I don't need to have hard time to live. Had Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised me of gardens, of rivers, of fruits, of all the things, the palaces, and the life partners, so much of promises which was not given to me when I was coming to the globe. I was not told, and I never knew in the globe I will help, but I came without knowing anyone. I was in the stomach of my mother, knew nothing to the limit. I was a baby. I did not know even to cry. I only cried when I came out. So I came out, only the thing I knew on the globe was to cry. Then I learned to speak. Then I learned to hear. Then I learned to see. Then I started learning one by one. To stand, to crawl, to walk, to think, to behave. All that I started learning. But the journey I am going to go to, I am ready. I can talk, I can speak, I can see, everything is fine with me. Plus, my destination is prepared for. And I am told this is your place. But only that, in the globe I am told you have either of two. In the globe I am being told you have either of the two, and you are given the choice also. But when I was coming to the globe, I was not given the choice whether I go into the stomach of that mother or this mother. I was not given the choice whether I come into Sri Lanka or come into Saudi Arabia. I was not given any choice. I was sent to a stomach and I became the son of that mother. And I was sent to a lane, I became the man of that lane. And I was sent to a community, I became a member of that community and I lived. That is what he willed upon me. But now when I'm going to go, he's telling you, choose where you want to go. You want to go to the hell or you want to go to the Jannah? You can choose. It's up to me. So it's a very easy way for me. Actually, this is easier than that. When I was coming, I have no choice. But now I'm going, I have enough choice. Whether I go to the hell or I go to the Jannah. Now this choice is the ticket what you buy. What ticket are you buying? Hell ticket or Jannah ticket? What ticket are you buying? The both tickets are put front of you. The ticket of hell is available. The ticket of Jannah is available. It's what I choose. But it's the craziness of me. We rush up and buy the ticket without looking what it is. Why? Because there's a guy who is doing this deception in his business. Who is that? Shaitan. He wants you to your eyes to be closed and not see what you are buying. And he's giving you only one ticket, the hell ticket only. So every one of us is trusting him. Oh, he's the great guy. Take the ticket from him. So you are just thrown into the hell one after the other. But there are some others who's giving you another ticket. There is to Jannah, the prophets. They're coming and calling to you. You go to Jannah. Ani abidullaha wajtanibut taghut. Worship Allah and keep away from the falsehood. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to preserve these creations, from time to time send the messengers, the revelations, to keep these creations safe from the cheating of the Shaitan. But how much did we consider? We were busy, no time, no time to consider what this prophet said to us. If only we can look into their teachings. And what has been revealed to them, the final and the last prophet, the messenger of Allah, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who revealed to us the last message of God, Allah, the Quran, the final commands, which if I can see, look, study, act upon. He not only sent you the clear guidance and commands, rather he sent his prophet to explain it, to elaborate it, to put it into practice and show to you how you have to do this. That is your ticket to Jannah. And the prophet explained it, showed it, practiced it. Also he produced another community of normal humans who are not perfects to live perfect and better. For anyway claim, prophets are secured by Allah, so they are being safe from shaitan and they can go to Jannah. While we are not secured by Allah, so we get tempted. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made this Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to prepare a generation, a community, which is his companions, the Sahabatu Ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in, who lived upon the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his clear teachings, acted upon it, and brought peace on globe after the darkness of its ignorance, brought humanity, brought harmony, and led life safe for them and safe for others. That's on the watch of the world, the remarks on them. And the remark of Allah from the sky upon them is what? Allah also said, رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُمْ. Allah also gave a better remark upon them. Allah also said very clearly, رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُمْ. Allah also said, Allah is pleased with them and they are pleased with Allah. Which is a guarantee of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sanctification upon their practicing the religion. Now my dear Muslims, those who want to be Muslims, you want to be satisfied by Allah, you have been shown an example in a way how it was satisfied. Get into their track, the way of the Sahabas. And those who do not know Islam, and those who take Islam for a joke, or for a ride, think it's just stories, it's just matters of arguments, it's just thoughts, philosophies, those who think about Islam such, I would like to give my message to them. Read the world history. Read the world history and be fair in studying and realizing what Islam did to the globe. How Islam progressed the human life, developed its peace and harmony in its history, and how much secure it brought to every individual of life on every globe. I'm not asking people to read the history of Rasulullah and Sahaba only, but even after that, if you know what is Islam, you'll love it. You'll prefer to be one of it. Rather, who studied Islam thoroughly and knew it actually, he will never ever avoid himself from joining Islam. Only those who did not read about Islam, did not know about the Muslims, did not know about the Islamic faith and its fundamentals, they turn out to be nasty and naughty at us. And they look at Islam the wrong way. They have misconceptions about Islam, misunderstandings about Islam, and they turn out troubling the Muslims who are living on the globe. They turn out thinking The Muslim and Islam is a trouble to them. Never. Islam was never a trouble to anyone. Islam and Muslims never ever will on the wealth of anyone. Not only on the non-Muslim, a Muslim is not allowed to take a penny of his own brother, which is forbidden. And we count it as eating hellfire in our stomach. Even of my own brothers, one penny is not allowed for me to take without his permission. Without his own goodwill, which we call stealing, theft. How dare a Muslim will ever love on the property of someone else? Nay and never. Rather we, if we want the world in its need, we work for it, we earn for it, and we earn it our own way, by the will of my Lord, by doing our activities. But we never jump on others' property, threaten them, and plug it out of them, and snatch it, and make it our way, in our living, in our earning. No, this theft, this stealing of others' property, by destroying others' rights, this system of right, is a totally forbidden thing in Islam. So we Muslims never in history count this as a thing permitted. Not only from our enemies is permitted, it's not even permitted. Even in our enemies, even if we Muslims happen to become the rulers or overtake lands, we have no right on the property of anyone. They ask to pay taxes only. This is how Islam had its authority. Muslims, yes, they always interfere only in one thing, trying to educate the whole community. That is, in the matter of their beliefs and thoughts, Islam kept on guiding, advising and educating. Why? Why? To secure the others from the anger of Allah. Because there is a damage happening to Allah which could end up on his anger. What's that damage? حَقُّ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْعِبَادِ أَنْ تَعْبُدُوهُ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ أَحْدًا. The rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with slaves is to worship Him and not to associate with Him. That's His rights. That's the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's rights are damaged, He will take care of what He wants to. History tells us the whole globe was wiped with water, with flood at the time of Nuh alayhi salam. History tells us a whole community was destroyed by sending them in between the sea, the community of Bani Israel of Pharaoh, the community of Pharaoh who opposed Bani Israel. Similar, at times Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has used the wind, use these different ways of destroying with damage His rights. And Allah says in the Quran, وَمَا يَعْلَمُ جُنُودَ رَبِّكَ إِلَّهُ. The army of thy Lord is never known by anyone except by Allah. No one can know who is the army of Allah. It can be the water, it can be the sea, it can be the wind, it can be anything. Will bring about a complete destruction if he wills it. He'll take over the lives. And if he does it, it's only a matter of him saying, kun fayakun, be and it becomes. So there's nothing then when if you say be to stop it. There's nothing. And we are not far away from learning such lessons. The tsunami which we had in Sri Lanka is not far away from how in minutes acres of land were wiped away. Properties were put into dust. Lives gone, taken. Nothing could ever think to stop it. Not what it passed, nor what it is going to happen. And also we cannot forget about the landslides. How Allah wiped away communities. So we cannot also forget about the floods, which took away everything with one wash, which has been witnessed by our own lifetime. I'm talking about things which our own lifetime has witnessed this. If these are not going to teach us lesson, we might need a thing worse than this. Are we expecting that? Are we waiting for that? For our Lord is able to do anything. So I call upon everyone in Sri Lanka. The battle which you are doing against Muslims, the trouble which you are creating to Muslims, is not for Muslims. It's for their faith. And this faith is not a faith what we decided and created for our own. Rather, this is the faith which our Lord asked us to abide by it, and we abide by it. We believe it. Thus we are called as Muslim, because we are the submitters to His commands, His orders. This is what we call our belief. And we take into account our belief very seriously. Our belief is what that is going to give us the rewards in the life and the hereafter. As a Muslim, forming my belief, the foremost. Whether I live in a palace, or I live in a cottage, in a village, or I live under a tree, there is no difference between me and him. The belief is the one big difference. If I have a faith in my Lord, my belief is firm, I am the biggest secured guy, even though I be sleeping under the tree in the jungle daily. But my Lord has told to me very clearly, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَ اللَّهِ ثُمْ اسْتَقَامُوا تَتَنَزُّلُ عَلَيْهِمْ مَلَائِكَةٌ أَلَّا تَخَافُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا وَبَشِّرُوا بِالْجَنَّةِ الَّتِي كُنْتُمْ تُوعَدُونَ. Those who said our Lord is alive was firm upon Him. We will get down for them angels. They may not fear us. وَأَبْشِرُوا بِالْجَنَّةِ الَّتِي كُنْتُمْ تُوعَدُونَ. And have the good tidings of the Jannah, the paradise, which has been promised to you. Allah is also telling to us in that another portion, what is in the world, angels will be put down. Will be getting down to preserve you, to save you, so that you will need to. Fear or she also is telling another thing. If you happen to die, also have the good tidings. What is that? وَأَبِشُرُوا بِالْجَنَّةِ الَّتِي كُنْتُمْ تُوعَدُونَ. And the good tidings of the paradises which has been promised to you. So for a Muslim, it's not a condition that I have to live. It is a condition I have to be truthful to my Lord. I have to be sincere to my Lord. I have to be honest to my Lord. And upon that, if I have to live, He will give me angels to secure me, save me. For what He wants to secure me. But He wants to take me, He has His way of taking me. Just with the pain, I can die. With no reason I can die. I can die, I am sleeping on my bed. I can die, I am talking. I can die, I am just with no anything, a cause for it. Or I can die by taxi. I can die by attack. I can die by either way. But the death is a thing, you are going to meet it. And who will decide when is it? Allah alone will decide, this is the time for my slave to come to me. And when He decides that time, there's nothing in the globe which is going to put it ahead or put it before. Not a minute, not a second. Nothing. knowing that as a Muslim, I'm not afraid of the death. If it is written to me, it has to come upon me. There is no power under the sky, above the earth, to change that death for me. So it's foolishness of worrying about it. But I am only bothered to be truthful at the time of that death, sincere at the time of death, humble so that my Lord be pleased with me. So that my next journey, the immediate after the breath departs my body, I'm secure. The minute the ruh, the soul departs my body, I'll be into another Jannah if I live the right way. The angels will be carrying me in that note. In that funeral gathering with mask and beauty which will be shown to my eyes before I depart from this globe, my place in Jannah or Jahannam. And I will be willing, when I see of what I have to meet from this journey to the next journey, if a believer, when he sees his Jannah, he will say, Ya Allah, take me, take me, take me. He will not want this world at all. So lovely, so comfort and great is that Jannah. Same way, if you see the one who is disobedient, his position of death, he will never will the death. He will be afraid to death. So my dear Muslim, my dear human community, prepare for this death. Get ready for this death. Muslims are also going to meet the death. Non-Muslims are also going to meet the death. Whether we are on our bed or under the sword, we have to meet it. Whether we are young or old or health or sick, the death is a thing every one of us is going to meet. Don't say to me, don't talk about it. It's going to trouble our life and thinking that you are the biggest fool on the globe. You're going to meet that. There's a destination you have to cross. In the journey of your life, that's a junction you have to cross. You don't think you can go and take a U-turn. It's not going to happen. You have to cross it. And that crossing is from the minute you depart this life and the journey of this life, you are going to be out of your control. Today I'm in my control. I can talk. I can see. I can hear all what I think, what I want. But the minute I'm put into my next journey, you can't control yourself. You will be controlled. The journey which we are going to come across, every soul is going to come across that journey. No one can ever think, no, I will escape from it. No, you are going to meet it. The day the soul departs your body, whether on your bed or on the road, the minute, the second the soul departs your body, you will be started, counted, and monitored by other than yourself. As long as you are upon the sand, below the sky is still a dead body, you will be washed by others. You will be dressed by others. Which you used to do yourself for you, now you can't. You used to walk and go, now you will be taken up by others on their shoulders. And where will they put you? Under the ground. Under the sand. Your own family members, your own beloved ones will do this, not your enemies. They will go you and put you in a sand pit alone and come back. That's if it's for a Muslim. Are they a Muslim? Sorry to say, Some will be burnt in the fire, which is the immediate start of punishment to them by their own beloved ones. Before the God starts accounting and punishing or rewarding, their own beloved ones start punishing them by burning them, which is a pain which every creature will feel it, but only they can't do it. So sorry to say, those humans who had taken this as a methodology to burn their beloved ones in the fire, they prepared securely that nothing of it is escaped, till the whole thing turned into ash. They crashed into the fire. My dear, there's nothing more bigger than that. But the mercy of Islam, my beloved ones won't punish me after that. From the minute my soul departs me, my families, my friends, my people will be praying to the Lord for the mercy of me, for the safe of me, for the security of me. Plus, everyone will see how we can forgive him, how we could be good to him. And those who have been wrong to him will be worried and grieved and try to be good to at least his family members, his kith and kin. And the minds change, the behaviors change, people become kind and polite, think about the death, about his past life, how he has been doing, what he has been telling, how he has been cooperating, all this, and feel sorrow for what he couldn't do, he couldn't reach, or where they couldn't support him. This is how a Muslim will be considered after death. And with the best of the available cloth, they will dress us. The best of the available water, they will wash us very securely, very decently, very perfectly. We will be washed, cleaned, dressed, and then we'll be taken to our best place, the house of Allah, and the prayers will be conducted and asked by the whole community from Allah to preserve us, to save us in our grave. They will pray, but this time when they are praying, they are not going to pray for themselves. They are praying for the dead body. Oh Allah, save him. Oh Allah, forgive him. Oh Allah, make him in cold and comfort. All this will be the du'as. And they will bury him. After burying him, they will go back home. And their wives are commanded to stay 4 months and 10 days, remembering their husbands. The respect Islam gives to their dead bodies. And every kitab din has been given 3 days to think about this and worry, but not to waste their life exceeding that. But 3 days for mourning is allowed in Islam, to mourn on the death. With the great beauty of Islam, if I die. Plus, when I was living, the good I did, the knowledge I spent, the knowledge I spread, whatever is being heard and acted, although I am dead in my grave, whatever the knowledge I spread which is being acted, whoever act on it, that reward is going to be sent to me. Subhanallah, a bank which is going to give you profit with no loss. And whatever the good charity I spent, which is continually being a charitable place for another living to benefit from it, I'll be rewarded. The good children which I built, they raise their hands and ask it to Allah, be accepted for me in my grave. Me remembering my father, asking forgiveness, my father in the grave, Allahumma ighfir li walidayya when I say the grave, he will be given a peace of mind. The security then will be. You ask what happened? No, your son asked Allah for you, it will be confirmed. This great Islam, which leaves me so comfort even after my death. This Islam doesn't depart me after my death. The Islam which I practiced, the submission to Allah which I did, the truthfulness to Allah which I behaved, all these actions will come to me when I am laid down into my grave. يُؤْتَى بِرَزُلٍ حَسَنٍ بِوَجْهٍ حَسَنٍ وَبِرِيْهٍ حَسَنٍ. The hadith of Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, your good actions will be brought to you like a beautiful figure, like a good smell of that which is giving good tidings. When I see that, I say, Ahlan bik, most welcome of you. What you bring to me? He will say, Ana amaluka al khair. I'm your good actions. Wallahi ma ra'aytuka illa sari'an li ta'atillahi wa bati'an li ma'asi. By Allah, I never saw you. And then rushing up for Allah's obedience. And hesitating to disobey him. It will be told to him, Nub nawmatul ahus. Sleep the sleep of a guru. وَيُرَى مَكَانُهُ فِي الْجَنَّةِ. Now he says his place in the paradise will be shown to him. When he sees his place in the paradise, he will love it so much, the great thing is being made in his head. يَا رَبْ أَقِيمِ الْقِيَامَةِ يَا رَبْ أَقِيمِ الْقِيَامَةِ يَا رَبْ أَقِيمِ الْقِيَامَةِ will be the dua of the dead. Who Allah established the Qiyamah? Who Allah established the Qiyamah? Who Allah established the Qiyamah? Why? Because he wants to go there quick. He loves it. Similarly, the slave, which has been disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he is laid into the grave, يُؤْتَى لَهُ عَمَلُهُ بِوَجْهٍ أَقْبَهٍ وَرِيهٍ نَتٍ يُؤْتَى بِهِ شَرٍ أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. The grave is put, that which never believed in Allah, that never obeyed Allah, submitted to Allah, his actions also will come in front of him. With a very bad smell, with a frightening figure. And that priest bed, what will the body say? La'anatullahi alaik. The body will curse him. The curse of Allah be upon you. Father, you tell me, what are you praying? Now I am cursing myself. Then will be the position of the disobedient. Then it will say, Ana amaluka ashar. I'm your actions, the bad actions. Wallahi ma ra'aytuka illa batiyan li ta'atillah wa sariyan li ma'asi. May Allah, I never saw you other than rushing up to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and hesitating to obey him. وَيُفْرَشْ لَهُ فِرَاشٌ مِنَ النَّارِ. The hadith says, a carpet of fire will be carpeted to him. He'll be sleeping on the fire carpet. He'll be burning on the hellfire. وَيُرَى لَهُ مَكَانَهُ فِي جَهَنَّمِ. His place in the hellfire will be shown to him. When he sees that he'll be his shoes, worse than the hellfire, worse than his grave in the hellfire, what he will say? Ya Rabbi, la taqim al-qiyam. Ya Rabbi, la taqim al-qiyam. Ya Rabbi, la taqim al-qiyam will be the cry of that day. He will say, oh Lord, don't establish the qiyam. He will prefer to stay on the fire bed than go into the qiyam. This is the truth of the journey of every soul. My message to the humans, this is the truth of the journey of every soul. Whether you like it or you don't like it, either of that is my journey. May Allah preserve us to have our best graves and to enter the Jannah with His peace and blessings. Yeah, that's what we all will allow. But we have to deserve for it. We have to be worth enough to be rewarded of such a grave. What's that? Act upon what Allah said. Act upon what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. Live a life, as Allah said, وَدْخُلُوا فِي السِّلْمِ كَافَةً. Enter the submission completely. My dear, you know how much you are truthful to your Lord. We need not a third guy to interfere to me in this subject. I don't want anyone, Tom or Dick and Harry, to come and tell, hey, you are correct or you are wrong. Before that I should know, how good am I to my Lord? How truthful am I to my Lord? How sincere to my Lord? Learn His commands, His demands, His orders, His kalam, the Quran. See, where are you from in? Look into the teachings of the Prophet, which explains to His commands, His orders. See, where are you from it? This is how you become firm in your faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My message to every soul, you are studying the Quran, you are studying the ahadith of Nabi Sallam, the tradition of Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Is the mercy upon you, you are doing for your own self. You are not doing good for anyone, my dear, when you learn the Quran and act, when you learn the hadith and act. You are doing the good for you. You are preserving yourself from the dangers of the hellfire. You are preserving yourself to live a better life in the world and the hereafter. You ignoring the Quran and Sunnah, the biggest damage you are doing for yourself. You are not harming anyone, you are harming yourself. In the world and the hereafter. And to my non-Muslim living fellow members of the human life, I would like to say, you ignoring the command of the Lord who created you, Allah. You ignoring the teachings, the commands, the orders which He sent to His messengers, the Quran. You are only earning His anger. In the world and after death. The worst thing you could do for yourself. We feel sorry for you. For all those who have not read the Quran and understood it. For all those who has not looked into the teachings of our Prophet, the Messenger of Allah, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who take him for something and avoid him. Poor guys. You are in a great loss, my dear. Your life is into a great danger. With whatever wealth or property or whatever authority you live. I call upon every soul on this globe. The kings, the rulers, the rich, the poor, everyone. Look upon to the word of Allah, the Quran, the message, which is sent for every one of us. It's not only for Muslims, for everyone, this Quran. You have to read it, you have to look it, you have to see if you have studied it. You have looked into it, you are a lucky man. You are a lucky guy. You have chances to be into His mercy and blessings if you act upon it. But my poor, my dear, living member of the globe, being alive when you never had a chance to look into the Quran. Never had a chance to look into the message of the last Messenger of Allah. Whoever you be, my dear, there's no bigger loser than you. Whatever the lawmaker you can be, whatever the great master you can be, whatever the great king you can be, whatever the great ruler you can be, whatever the authority you can hold, but I tell you, believe me, you are the worst lost guy. And you will worry it, and it will be too late for you. When the time you will be departing this life to the journey of to the next life, whether you know it or you don't know it, that time you will have to worry, and you are too late for you. My message to all, look into the Quran. Look into the teachings of the Messenger of Allah, who was sent as Rahmatun Lil Alameen. It's the mercy to the two universe. And he didn't come to cheat you. Rather he came, as he says, إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ فَرْقًا بَيْنَ النَّاسِ. I was sent between mankind to divide and show, I mean the good and the bad. So he was so clear, to tell you what is right and what's wrong, nothing left cheated. And the Quran was so clear, كِتَابٌ عَرَبِيٌ مُبِينٌ. Very clear Arabic book. It's we who did not make ourselves clear by reading and understanding. It's we who did not differentiate between the truth and the falsehood by looking by the teachings of the Messenger of Allah who came to divide between the truth and the falsehood, showed us everything. In this opportunity, I take the chance of calling every religion, every philosophy, every lawmaker, every ruler, every authority, every land, every human. Look into the Quran, the message of Allah. It's for each individual of you, you need it. Each king needs it. Each ruler needs it. Each person on the authority needs to look into the Quran directly, personally, understand it. You'll see the great thing in the Quran. You'll see the great miracles in the Quran. You'll see how clear, how wisdom, how strong, how perfect, how unique its rulings are. It'll serve every of your field. If only you can open this book and look into its teaching. And I ask you all, what damages you in reading it? Take from your time as you look into all other issues, a time to look into the book of Allah. I call upon everyone on the globe. Even those who say and blame the wrong about our Islam and try to discriminate or degrade us, whatever you have about us, I ask you once again, look into the book of Allah, but please, look it to understand in Arabic. Never tell me, I saw it a translation version. Any translation version, we cannot give you the guarantee what's worth in Arabic. So if you are unable to know Arabic, take your time to learn the Arabic language. It's a language like any other language. And then go back to this Quran and see. You see the greatness of this book. It's a miracle. It's a miracle. It was a miracle. It is a miracle. And it will remain a miracle. It changed generations. It brought peace. Everything by us believing on it, acting upon it. I want the President of Sri Lanka, Mr. Maitri, to look into the Quran, to read into its teaching and tell me where you find wrong in it. I want the Buddhist monks to read the Quran and tell me where do you find wrong in it. I'm ready to answer it. I want every religious leader, every politician to look into the Quran and tell me where you find wrong in it. I'm responsible to stand for it. As a person which Allah has bestowed to me, learn this Quran and understand. I stand for it and my life is for it. At any place, at any time, I am ready to serve my Quran. I want the President, the Prime Minister, the whole authority body of Sri Lanka take this seriously. My message is to all of them, read the Quran, look into it and tell me, what do you say about Muslims, which the Quran calls upon? And if we are not upon to what our Quran say, tell us, we have to be upon us. Tell us to be on our Quran, not on our themes and joys. I call upon the country. I call upon the authority. The Book of Allah is the message to you and me and to every human life which lives on the globe. And it's not special to Sri Lanka. It's to the whole globe. It's not only special to this time of period of living. It's forever living in the world. A book with commands and teachings and guidelines, which is a perfect book. Not a single mistake in it. Nothing, no one can point a finger to this book. And if anyone think he can point, let him come to me, I'll tell him where he's getting his finger trapped into it. I'll tell him where he's wrong. I want this message to be very clear. The Book of Allah is a message for the president of Sri Lanka, like for the ruler of anyone. For the Prime Minister of Sri Lanka and like the Prime Ministers or the rulers of any land. For the religious leaders of Sri Lanka and like for the religious leaders of anyone. For the politicians of Sri Lanka and like the politicians of anyone, any authority. If they are going to handle without knowing Quran, I'm sure you're going to do enough blunder, enough damage, and you are going to get it. You are going to get it from the Creator of you, He will take care of it. We are telling you, my dear, as a member living in this land, I need Allah's mercy and blessing to be bestowed on the whole land, not only for me and my house, and for members and my families. No, I want the whole globe and the land be preserved with the mercy of Allah and the blessing of Allah, where every life can live in peace and harmony. That's the reason I'm calling you to look upon the Quran. It's teaching. So that you also share the blessings and the mercy of the Lord. And everyone live in a peace and harmony. And let's know what we have to do to earn this peace and harmony and the mercy. Let's not wander about creating a peace and harmony which is a building castles in the air. We all are willing for peace and harmony. But I tell you, you're just building castles in the air, my dear. Till you look into the Quran, you will never bring peace and harmony on the globe. Till you practice the teachings of Quran, you will never bring peace and harmony on the earth. Don't tell me this is racism. No, this is the fundamental of peace and harmony. Because just someone couldn't understand Quran, someone couldn't understand Islam, they have their own teaching and they are racist to it. As I hold to the teachings of Quran, you want to call me I'm racist to it? Nay, never. I'm ready to stand for what the Quran said. You find fault in it? Come, we'll look into the matter. We're ready for it. And I wouldn't ask you, please listen to this very carefully, I wouldn't ask you, I will never ask you, are you ready to challenge the mistakes in your religion? If I ask for it, I will never ask that, my dear. And I don't want to do that. I'm not ready to point the fingers at you all. And I'm not ignorant of it also. But that's not my way of handling the matter. For I know where my religion is and where you all are. I know. I feel sympathy towards you. I feel sad for you all. But I have a duty to handle it. I have a duty in front of my Allah. Because I learned His teachings. I understood His teachings. I have a responsibility in front of Allah that I had to be fair enough with everyone. As a teacher in the classroom, I'll not point my finger at the weak student and keep the best student No, but I'll be fair enough with all my students and try to educate them and try to make them understand. I will suffer for it. I'll take my whole hardship that all my people are served properly. That's the only reason. Please listen this very carefully. That's the only reason that we don't want to point our fingers at other religions. Otherwise, things be very, very, very bad. Very, very worst. That's not how our religion taught us. That's not how Islam taught me to behave with other religion. But my religion teaches to be kind to you all of you. To be polite to all of you. Because you all have made up religions with your own thoughts and philosophy, thinking that is fair and good. We are sorry for you, my dear. You can have your belief. We don't rush into the judgment. Which is for us is our judgment. You can have your ruling. But my dear, similarly, I want you to respect our religion. As we respect your religion, with whatever the value or level it is, we never interfered our talkings into your religion. We never pointed our fingers at you all. But we also understand very clearly that there are a lot of blunders, wrong teachings, misconceptions, wrong ways about our religion by some, those who are ignorant or troublemakers or people who has been taken for a ride for some other reason. Even to them I would say, my religion of Islam tells me for a direct talk of peace, I am ready to emulate, explain why we Muslims are living upon our Islam, why we need our religion. And I want everyone in this country to understand that Islam is a religion of the Creator. It doesn't belong to me that I brought it from my philosophy and I want to promote it. No. It's the religion of my Lord who created me. He commanded me, I obey. He will reward me. He will protect me. He will take care about me. And that religion and its teachings, its guidelines, is a duty upon every creation to abide by it. Not only for me. And those who did not abide for it, don't think you will be ignored. Rather Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord of the universe, He will take account of it. Yes, He is so merciful that He gives you enough time. He gives you enough time to learn, to understand, realize. Take the lives you are living, the time which is granted you in understanding this religion. This is my message to everyone in the globe, especially to the people in Sri Lanka. And please look into the Quran. Anything you have in it, which you think might be wrong, I am at your service. You can call me on my mobile, 07-222-512-77. Anytime we are at service. 07-222-512-77. Anytime we are at service to explain you the teachings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Least people in authority at least understand it and make the ignorance and the riots to understand it or control them so that the community can live in peace and harmony. Due to the leaders and the authorities not realizing the proper Islam concept, they have no idea what to do. They're wandering about and they can never bring things under control. And I tell you, it's not the first time we experience trouble. We will be experiencing trouble again and again, ever and ever, not only by this community or by that community or by him or them, as long as Islam is misunderstood. Islam has to be understood. And every of our Muslims has to work enough to make the message of Islam clear. And the first duty of us is we live properly in our Islam. And we talk to Allah, sincere, humble, so that our living will give a good example for the others to see what Islam is. This is my message to everyone. If I had told of anything of good, that's the mercy of my Lord upon me. He gave me the chance to pronounce it and to pass this message across the creations. If any of the mistakes I have done in my pronunciation, that's of me and from the traps of the devil, which might be even on me as a soul, which I ask my Lord to preserve me from it and secure me from that. That's my Allahu alone can guide me to the truth and form me in it. It's me upon to struggle on it and search it and realize it and submit to it. هذا ما عندي فأنا سبت من عند الله من أخذت من نفسي من الشيطان والله أخذت